back to my talkie here. I haven't had much luck with these lately. I've been deleting them, and so this one I'm gonna try to maintain its stability on this internet. And anyway, I'm doing a lot of these notebook covers, and I'm going with more and more like a history theme, which is kind of like exciting for me. I love history. I love ancient history. I love the mythology theme, the Greeks, the Romans, all of this. It gets very exciting. So I'm trying to keep it along that. And even with Asia also, bringing in ancient Asia. So I have made a few kind of funny ones, like the Voyage of Love with the Keepers of the Serpents. That one's neat. Where the six ants, it has six ants, you know, and the ants are, they're oppositional to the love match. Because apparently it's a love time, and there's supposed to be a marriage going on, and the guy's reading the scroll and saying it's time for this engagement to happen, and then there's the match made in heaven woman, and she's there saying yes, this is supposed to go on, and yet there's the six ants, who are the keepers of the serpents. Now they are the keepers of the dragons, so each one of them has a dragon. So it's kind of neat. If you can imagine this in a movie theme, I could see Angelina Jolie already as the dragon woman, as one of the ants, and even Meryl Streep would be a good dragon woman, also. So yeah, you could have these older actresses like come out and really do their thing, you know. So yeah, they're oppositional to the marriage. They don't want these two marrying, and they each has their own reason, you know. Of course. You know, one wants them to, you know, your travel is going to be upset. You're only ever going to see the Great Wall. You're not going to even get on an airplane. You know, whatever. You know, one aunt is saying this, and then her dragon, and then another one is saying, you know, she's just too meek for you. She's just too below your status. You know, she's just a farm peasant. All of that is going on. You know, back to The Great Pearl. I don't know if you've ever read that one. I believe it's The Great Pearl. Yeah, or something like that. Back to when they were out there in the field, you know, just working, like, can't believe. And the that, so you have that aunt. I'll just say wrong status, you know, cut that off. And then there's going to be the other aunt, and so each, if you can be a ballet also, of course, you can have each dragon be either a woman or a man dancer, but it has to be a real supple one. Yeah, so you'd have to have six very supple dancers to be the mate. Essentially, they're the mate with each aunt, their partner, their cohort, you know. They just do everything together. They think alike, you know. And so even in the night, you know, you think, oh my gosh, you know, she becomes that beast. Yeah, so it's a very interesting idea. I really like it, and I think it kind of, it goes into the mystic, and it goes into fantasy, of course, but it also goes into folklore, and that style. Yeah, there's very many reasons why that marriage would be stopped, you know. Very many reasons, you know. The status, the you know, the just the plain, you know, she's uncultured, you know. That one. She has no culture, you know. She's not from our ilk, you know. She doesn't have our strain of culture. Yeah, so you'll have that one aunt, and then she'll just be hitting that one heavy, you know. You know, so all of those types of things. And then the other one will say, beauty, her beauty is missing. You know, where is her beauty? I did see a little glimpse of, it was a woman, a young woman, and apparently she damaged her looks. Her vanity is completely destroyed now. Well, it's a ruined vanity. She had like a perfect face already. She's Asian actress, like a Lu Ling or something. And then she just kept having it operated on and operated on and operated on, and now they burnt her nose off, and it's just a disaster. So her whole face is destroyed, and I don't know. People, I guess they don't want to stop. They don't want to stop that habit. And she was so young, too. That's a shame. Anyway, so. Well, she still is young, I imagine. So I've been doing that type, and then I have done a few kind of like regular, more just like it's a notebook, like space gems, and that was actually kind of fun. It's just space gems, but more Celtic style, space and gems together, and then other styles. I went with the Cats of Cloud Nine, which I believe is something we all need to see. It could be a movie. It could very well be a movie. Ridiculous cats on their cloud. So that one's a kind of a fun one, but just like a go take to school type. And I am switching out. I did make some. They're more category oriented ones, like the spell casting one, and the cuisine and the bridal notes. Those ones I'm switching them over into journal. I made my own journal interior. So each page will have a nice little title section, so you can write. A title on each page if you want. I think that was missing. It was just college rule before or wide rule, but now it's a wider rule, but it's the journal style that gives you that little title for each page. And you can put the date or whatever, and I think that will help those particular ones, or the recipe name, because if it for the cuisine book, you might want to know the recipe that you're really thinking about there. So there. Anyway, I've been making a lot of these ancient ones. I went with Cornelia and Julius. Cornelia and Julius in their palatial gardens, in their palace gardens. And that's really about Julius Caesar and a time in his life when he was married. And he kept that marriage, and he had to go into hiding because of it. So it was actually kind of a marriage. It was a scandal because he didn't divorce her. He was supposed to divorce for political marriage, and he didn't do so. So he had to go into hiding. So it goes. It's kind of that. So you can see the two there in their moment. That's kind of a funny one for Italy. I made another one. Triton rescues Athena from the ghost pirates, and I think that's kind of my most, what do you call it, action-packed adventure style that I have going. That's not really my genre so much, but people like that. People like that action. You see the ghost pirates out there fighting. Like you've seen them fight in those games, those video games. They always have those ghost pirates with the sabers. So that type of thing. It's just a tedious chore though, because I'm very slow at this, and then I make so many mistakes, and I cut off Athena's foot, and so then I had to do the whole thing over again. And then the spacing is wrong. The margins are so like difficult. Even at 800, I'm at 800 on this machine, getting at that degree of magnification, and yet it is impossible to get the margins exact, So it's even at that magnify. So this is going on. And I can't handle it. I'm just that type of person. I want to have the edge. I want to have a nice edge. And it's just trying to fool me. Anyway, so I did all of these like historical ones. I believe there was another one. I did Lady of the Fans, which is more of a Chinese folklore. She's a neat lady. She just and it's in her house. And it could even be a modern day woman now, but she has fans everywhere, and they're just the regular type, you know, and like a Spanish fan. And she just hangs out in her house apparently, and she puts on masks, and then she waves her fans, you know, and she has powers. She's a magical power type of a woman. And she can make the whole town go to sleep. She can quiet. She can tame the seas. So she's very powerful. So yeah. So that type of a magic story. All of these, of course, can be ballets. I just get into the story right. And eventually, I will try to make a compilation, put them together, and actually, you know, spell out verbatim the stories. But right now, I'm still in the creative mode of their picture. You know, I have to make the picture before I can create the story. So that's just the way I am. And so I'm going through this, and then I'm going slower and slower, of course. You know, what I did, I made the space gems, you know, as a levity one, and then there was another one I made as a levity, but I can't even think of it right now. But yeah, meanwhile, I've been working very diligently, and I'm not really campaigning anymore. I've kind of put that at a halt. Just because of the cost, and I'm building this repertoire, and I think I'm just gonna try to get sales off my author page more so. You know, maybe that'll be something. What else? What else? Oh, I wanted to talk about criticism. I'm very, very much into criticism of this time frame, criticism of this ecology disaster time frame. And I know it doesn't fly with a lot of you. A lot of you want pleased and pleasant, and life is great, and life is wonderful, and we just go through the steps and passages of our life, and that's that. But that's not accounting for your effort in the life and your doing in the life and what others are doing in the life that are ruining the planet. So I'm always seen as the bad guy, you know, because I mention these things. And here we are at CO2, we're still at 419.7 or something. You know, it's still at like a stagnant halt. It has not taken a big dive down. And that is a drama. You know, supposed to have already said, "Hey, I'm gonna drop now." But this year, it's just in a big bloom, and it doesn't want to. So here I am, and I say these things, and then I'm like, "Well, yeah, I guess I am an energy that is oppositional to people who want to just see life as pleasing." Want to see life as great and wonderful. I guess I am that devil's advocate in a way. Is that that's the terminology, the devil's advocate? Yeah, I guess I am that, you know, because I am telling you that no, it's not done, it's not clear, it's not perfect. You know, we have this going on, we have Rads that are very, very high. You know, if you look at my nose real close, you would see it. You would see that skin, that sun damage. You would see the ruin I'm not supposed to look like this at my age. That's the ruin from our earth situation. So anyway, I so I made a list. I did. I thought it was actually kind of chipper too. It was like a chipper because here you are, you're 15 years old, and you're looking at Greta Thunberg, I believe that's her name, and she's out there. She's pounding the streets. She's pounding the gavels out there on these big meetings, isn't she? And she's saying, "This is the way it is, you know." And then she's telling these kids in Canada, and millions show up. And they're like, hell yeah, you know, we're not getting the right world that we wanted, you know. So these millions of kids are showing up, and they're pounding their feet, and they're not happy. But unfortunately, that is still seen as we're cynics. We're that's cynicism. That's you looking at the cup half full. You're not looking at, hey, we're making efforts and strides. No, we're not making efforts and strides enough. You can look at your own little tangent, your own little tiny minuscule life, your own little place in your own little community, and you can say, you think that you're making a stride, you think that you're going forward ecology-wise, but then you have to understand there are entire countries, like, and I mean continents. You look at Africa. In an entire continent like Africa that is demanding big screen TV. You know, so they haven't even gotten on the big screen TV bandwagon yet. They want those. They want it in their living room. They want to hype out just like these Americans, just like these Europeans. They don't care the planet. They want because they believe they have the right to have it if they can afford it. That's it. It's as simple as that. There is no eco consciousness associated with that. It's simply you have it, I want it also. You know, they don't want to be deprived. They're tired of being third world. They want that big screen TV. And no, they don't necessarily want to steal it out of your house. They want it in their house. They want to even purchase it. So here we are. We're looking at that situation. And we're at what, like just a smidgen under 420. And you have to start looking at all these other continents, all these other third worlds that are having, we're having like an interesting economic, I often say, you know, it's Asia and India right now. We're just under their foot. And then I have to explain. Can you explain that? How can we be under their foot? It looks like we're so rich, you know. It does have the appearance of being so rich. But you have to remember, each business, each small business, each entrepreneur that is out here in we'll say the United States, it could be Europe, it could be the UK, each one that is out there, they're doing their business, they're doing their work, and they have a competition of somebody selling the same product for $18 when they sell for $20. The $18 one wins. The $18 one is maybe manufactured in a cheaper location, it's put together with cheaper labor, it's $18. So the guy who has his for sale for 20 goes out of business. So we lose that entrepreneur. We lose that small business in the United States or in France or UK. We lose them. And guess who wins? It's the one who's 18. And the 18 is, let's say it's in India now, an outsourcing company in India. Outsource on the telephone for tech support or something. So yeah, we've lost to them. Then we've also lost to China also for another 18 over here on some other guy's business, or some other gal's business. And so all of these start to just trickle and trickle and trickle and trickle. So it doesn't matter. We are always being replaced by the cheaper, more affordable. Therefore, how are we going to compete with that when they are always able to just say, it's my 18 that wins. And then here goes that at this point now, that's really great. You know, so they ran that guy, gal out of business on their 20. And here's the 18 going, well, I think we're going to creep it up to 19 now. So they can creep up the price now to 19. They can even stir a little and even get a dum-dum entrepreneur here in the States to say, hey, I could maybe compete with them. And so he'll try and he'll lose his shirt. But that's the way it's going. Just competition from there. Competition from population. Population that can afford cheap labor, that can afford the cheap manufacturing and the cheap wages, and apparently the cheapest shipping on the planet. So yeah, so I really feel like we are minions because we do not have an absolute. This is ours, you know. This is ours, it's made here, it's purchased here. It is not minusculed away here. It's not minusculed away by another continent. You know, you're making your beads here. Here we are, the Indians, we're making our beads. And no, not here. Got to make them over there. Somebody else has to make those beads. So then you have to buy the beads. I've even gotten things from native donation places, and they're made in China. They're made in China. The wreath, the native what do you call that? The dream wreath. Yeah, the angels go through it or don't go through it, or you trap bad dreams in it. And one of those, so catcher, dream catcher, yeah, made in, not the United States. No. So always made somewhere else. Anyway. So it's all about the purchase. Now, we have to purchase these items still, don't we? We have to purchase the items from these countries in order to maintain our status quo. And look, give the appearance that we are rich, give the appearance that we are wealthy. We have to keep buying their items because they're not our items anymore. Unless it was a few business people that did go over there and they did actually finagle and they do think they're making a profit, they are still in competition with the others. So they are also dancing on a fine line. So here we are. We have this, and they've got to keep being fed, you know, these big countries, these big populations like India and China. They have to keep being fed. And that's how they make their living, you know. They make their living selling to the US, selling to us. And if we're not buying, we're not able to purchase any longer. That becomes a big problem because they would have to lower their prices and they're not going to be able to do that. You know, that would be economy sinking, major economy sinking. As soon as the U.S. cannot buy the Chinese goods or or purchase the Indian tech support on the telephone, we sink. The world sinks. The economy around the world sinks. So who's propping it up right now? I see it as only those who have purchased extravagant stocks and we're lucky. You know, here we are. We have somebody that maybe you bought Amazon at $100 and it's $3,500 or something today. So maybe you bought, you know, $1,000 at $100 or whatever. And you're doing great. So you can keep propping it up. You can keep propping up the economy around the world, because it's not just ours, it's around the world. But eventually, this is my take on it, eventually people sell those stocks off. I had to sell my Amazon. I bought one of them for $500 and I sold mine off. And I didn't make it to the 3.5. So there are a lot of people that sell those stocks and they don't make it. They don't make that prop up buoyant economy. They siphon off. You know, other things happen. You have bills to pay. You know, and hey, maybe you really don't like that boss and you can't stand it, and so you're just getting out of that work, and you decide you're going to retire young. You're going to start pulling out of that market. So all of those buoyancies are gonna subside. I mean, we are going to run out of rich people one day. Anyhoot. Anything else that I had to say? Oh my gosh, gas today. I went to purchase gas. I was going to buy it yesterday, but there was a big line, you know, and I'm like, well, I'll get it today. 368 or something. It had gone up. So it was $40 to fill my little tank. Normally it's only like 28. So yeah, it was a big jump. I don't know what that's all about. And so immediately today I emailed my insurance company and I said, can you please put me on one of those, like, where I keep the car in the garage and I pay like just a tiny bit of insurance? Does that exist? You know? So I'm asking that big question. A parked car, you know. Anyway, guys, that's it. I don't have anything else aside from a whole bunch of notebooks. And like I said, I'm going slower because I've made so many mistakes. And I think when I first ramped up into this, I gave myself like a mini stroke, you know, because I hadn't been working on the earning of money, you know, direction for so long. And I'm panicking, you know, I don't have an income. And so I gave myself a stroke. But I'm much better now. I'm much better. I'm speaking clearly. And yeah, my legs are doing better. I took a walk today. Oh my gosh, I'm feeling good. Yeah. And a morning dove laid a little baby egg in the chicken's nest. Apparently it's illegal for me to raise it. I don't know where they come up with these rules, but it's illegal for me to actually put it under incubator light. So it's a tragedy because it's been very windy, and the bird was trying to put it in a safe place away from the wind because it probably lost its nest. I've had drowned birds this year in the pond. It's just been awful. The baby birds, you know, because they're up there, they put their nest up there and then shoo, down into the pond, you know. So this little tiny mourning dove. Anyway, I just left it there. So if the hens want to brood it, they can. But I don't think they will. I think they'll just leave it. So anyway, that's the big worry of the moment. And that's really what life is about, is those moments. And yet we have to think of the big economy stream, don't we? And the mechanism of earning a living. Ciao.